Well then, here we are. This is the little gallery that I'm building.
Right here in the center of Westfield.
You can't ask for a better spot. It's all about location, location, location. And that's only if the town's a nice location to begin with.
And this definitely is.
This definitely is. I think that Westfield right now is in a little bit of a renaissance, a rebirth, you may say, of the art and culture that was once here. And I can see all through the town that there's little parts of it coming together. And I feel that my part is to bring it all into focus, bring it all into one common theme, and that's to become the best, most popular place to learn about culture and the arts and to be part of it. What do you think?
I think you're definitely right. Why don't you show me in?
After you.
I'm gonna lock the door for us.
Come on in.
So, Jerry, I understand this used to be a restaurant.
Yes, this is Barney's restaurant, frequented by a lot of people in Westfield. And sometimes when I'm working on it, they stick their head in and say, is this going to be a restaurant?
and what do you tell them?
I say, well, a little bit of a restaurant because we're going to have a little serving area with limited food license and serve teas and fresh squeezed juices and coffees to give the people a chance to get off the street and sit down and relax, read the paper, talk about issues. So yeah, I tell them it's a little bit of a restaurant, but more important than that is upstairs we're going to have a teaching and learning center, a place where people can rent the space out by the hour and start small classes. The people that are in between teaching out of their home and teaching in a full-time, full monthly rental place, this way they can rent by the hour. And also downstairs, though, will be my gallery. We have some great artists coming in to fill the gallery up. Personally, I could fill it up myself, but that's not the point, just to show my stuff. I think it's important to show quality art. And with the gallery down the street has 39 artists. I'll probably stay somewhere between 6 and 8. But along the bottom of the whole gallery will be children's artwork.
Really?
Well, I think that all of humanity depends on our children.
So why is it going to be at the bottom?
Well, because I want the kids to enjoy their pictures, and most children are probably no taller than this, so if I let them enjoy their artwork at their level and make the parents get down like I am to see what the children are showing us, instead of making the children rise up to the adult world,
right,
make the adults
bring them
themselves
down
and look up at life like children do with awe and wonder.
Okay, so is anything going to be above the children's artwork?
Yes, what we'll do is we're going to section the areas off, have individual artists shown in individual areas. Mm-hmm. I have some special artwork. I have a deer and a waterfall picture that I have upstairs, and it's a series of 12 pictures, so that'll be in one spot. I have a friend that does beautiful panoramic pictures, and she'll show her pictures all around the top.
Mm-hmm.
I have an incredible glass worker. He takes depression area glass, cups and saucers and dishes and whatever you have, and he turns them into some incredible artwork as a stained glass piece.
Really?
Functional for lamps and whatnot, or art decorations like a stained glass window. And he does incredible work, and I think that people really enjoy seeing the stuff here. Besides that, we have a couple of local artists that we'd like to show. I have a friend that's helping me rebuild the place. He's a photographer. He'll be showing his stuff here. And we're going to use this as a hub of not only of a teaching learning center, but we also use this as a starting point for entering Westfield's cultural goals into my scheme of things. So since I got down here, I already started we're going to have our first art festival in Westfield.
So how are you going to find artists to show their work here?
Well, if the artists are good and they want to come to talk to me, we could find more artists to fit in. I'd like to show as many people as I can, whether they're beginning artists or very successful artists. But it'll also show Westfield that we have art here in the town. We used to have a thing called the West Fest, which is no longer here. It was the year I started the memorial. It started into art. I said, well, one of my goals is to be in the West Fest.
Right.
Well, the very first time I went to apply, no more West Fest. That used to be up at Stanley Park.
Right.
So this year I took the initiative, and we already secured the green right across the street for September 4th and 5th, which is Labor Day weekend.
And it's close to 9/11.
Exactly. so we could kind of get the point out about the memorial at the same time, and it'll just before, it'll be just a couple days before my trip down to Manhattan again, to the, you know, Twin Towers sites, where I'll be passing out my memorial pictures in support of all the people that lost again. And so we do have things moving in the right direction, and there's a lot of people that are very excited about not only the building, the art, but they seem to find a little excitement in me, and I don't know how that is, but if I could be the rallying cry for everybody to come together, and we could put together a cultural and art center and a teaching and learning center bigger than what I've already had started here, then I think some of my major goals in life would be accomplished.
It's like your sister-in-law said, when you get involved in a project, you run with it, and you keep running with it, and that gets everybody else excited about it.
Excellent point, because I also said before that it's your destiny, but now destiny's only fulfilled through determination.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to be determined. And to be determined, you have to work at it until you reach your goals. And I've never been one to set my goals low and say I've reached them. I set my goals extremely high, and those are my major goals. And then I just find a way to take step by step, just like in a ladder.
Right.
I don't take a 6-foot ladder and get to the top and say I'm there. I'll put an extension ladder up, and I'll take step by step until I'm not only at my goals, but I like to overachieve them.
So how long have you been working on the building, and when do you expect to be done with it?
Well, we purchased the building on March 4th. I started my photo shoot just like I did for the memorial, taking pictures all every step of the way. So basically, when we got in here, the first thing we did was take some pictures, and my wife is standing right over there where there used to be a wall, and she did something like this. I said, honey, let me get you a picture of you, and she said, okay, and she did this. I said, isn't that a teapot? She said, I'm a little teapot, short and stout. This is my handle, and this is my spout. So we started thinking right away, what's the name of the building going to be? And instead of being Gerald Eugene Tracy's Ising Ting Gallery or something of that effect, it turned out to be the Teapot Gallery, and it was cute.
Oh.
My wife loves children, and she's my driving force about getting the children
so
in
here.
So
we're going to be saying I'm a little teapot a lot?
A lot.
It's going to be a dance floor too, right?
This is going to be a beautiful hardwood dance floor, because as I've been introducing myself to the city, saying here I am, I've been finding that people all have something to offer, and with the excitement that's going on, one person came out and said, you know, I learned classical dance and Latin dance, and I would love to teach it. I said, well, if you'd love to teach it, then I'll make sure that there's a place in my gallery for you to teach
it. So is that going to happen down here, upstairs in the Learning Center?
It would happen right here. So what I did, instead of having a beautiful tile floor, we're going to go with a rock maple floor all the way across, and we're going to have our art displays. There'll be art on the wall, but there'll be displays in the center that I could just move right out of the way, open the place up, have some music.
Some drink.
Drinks, and some entertainment, and some nice lighting, and a ballroom spinning light, and everybody could be doing the merengue, the maramba, or whatever they call those dances that I'm going to have to learn too.
Yes.
And I was very optimistic that we would just step in here and for a few thousand dollars be able to just get into the place by April 13th. So I gave myself a 1-month, 2-week deadline. Then I started seeing the potential of the building was larger than I imagined, and that the work necessary to get it to that potential was larger also. So when we found that it had these beautiful tin ceilings hidden up above the drop ceilings, then I said, well, let's bring it back to the tin ceilings that were...
So what is the ceiling going to look like?
Well, what I did was, because there were so many damaged ceilings from them nailing the drop ceiling up, I had to replace certain tiles. And this is like a common fill pattern right here. So what we did was we looked through online, and there's at least 3 or 4 or 5 different tin making companies that make these panels. And we picked out this design that has kind of a nice airy look to it. It has the dragonflies, and people like my daughter love dragonflies. And it has the bamboo atrium look, so it looks like you're kind of outdoors. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take that and we're going to put it up on the ceiling in the center of each of these little breaks. And then what we're going to do is make it look like you're looking up through the sky. So we'll have it almost like you're outdoors. We'll bring some green up through the tiles and make it look like trees. We'll have these dark tiles along the wall that make it look like water. And we'll have that beautiful floor that'll give you the sense that you're on the ground. So we'll have all the aspects of the outdoors, indoors, including the front. When we do the front, it's going to open right out to the street, and it'll feel like you're sitting on the street with bricks down inside that little bit of a mess out in the front there. And that will really be the showcase of the place. You'll see it from the street, and you'll say, I've just got to walk in there. The place is exciting.
You've got to dance. You've got to look at some artwork.
Look at some artwork and have some tea and drinks.
Have some fun.
Exactly.
It'd be very relaxing, too.
Yes. And no pressure. And it's not like I even need sales. If I can get people to come here and enjoy themselves, and the price of the building was very modest compared to other cities around, that I know that I'm doing something special for my town that could outlive me and my children's children and start a legacy and like I said, try to bring Westfield to the center of the arts, then it's not important. The money's not important as much as the quality of life. And September 11th showed us that you're not guaranteed time on this earth. And if you're given a gift, then you really should use it because you're not sharing your gift with others, and that's what that gift's about. It's not doing for yourself, it's doing for the others. And by sharing that gift, you're teaching somebody else that they may have that gift inside them. And if you ever go up to your creator and you didn't use your gift, and the first things out of the creator's mouth will be, so Jerry, or Lynn, what did you do with your gift? And you say, I was going to use it, but I just didn't get around to it. Well, guess what? You're going to be a big letdown. So if you have a gift, no matter what it is, whether it's arts or sports or helping or religion, then do it. Do it for yourself, but you'll be doing it for humanity.
Yeah. Talking about gifts, why don't we go upstairs and look at your artwork?
This is one of my favorites right here. This is a local picture, and it's of a deer in a waterfall. Now, I've shown this picture quite a bit, and the same response is, wow. I've never seen a deer in a waterfall before.
Yeah, how close were you?
Well, I was with a small digital 2.1 camera, which I had just gotten in February for my birthday, and this was taken in November, just before we started the September 11th War on Terrorism Memorial. When I decided to be an artist, all these things came to me, and this picture is quite unique. You'd think that you had to travel across the world for this picture. And it's interesting because National Wildlife would tell you that most of the most interesting things in the world are in your own backyard. You just didn't see them.
This is in your own backyard.
This is in a river right in Westfield. So this makes this the only deer picture in the world, and it's in Westfield, the town I'm in.
I would never have known that it was Westfield if you hadn't told me.
Many people wouldn't, and I had a deal with the deer that I wouldn't tell anybody, but I heard that the deer died.
Oh.
It got hit by a car last year, and this was 2-3 years ago, so it was very huge. But it was nice that National Wildlife put it in their magazine because being a digital age, so many things could be manipulated. And they were most of the people that I gave this picture to thought it was a camera manipulation on the computer. But they realized that these things do occur, and they put it in their magazine under Right Place, Right Time.
Yeah.
And it was one of my goals as an early artist was to be internationally published and to be known in all households within 5 years. So I'm working very hard at those goals.
You're working very hard.
This is only my third year, and it just started, and this is my third year, and I already have a gallery set up.
Right. Can I see some more of your pictures?
I'd love to show you some. These are some of my abstracts that I did. What I did was, this is with magic marker, and it's something that I used to do in ninth grade when I used to be an artist in school. And my art teacher used to always tell me, you're going to have to go to art school. Instead, what did I do? I traveled. But because my path was already set for me, the traveling didn't hurt because I ended up coming back to doing what I was meant to do.
Mm-hmm.
So I took these pictures. This is the first one I used color markers. And when I did my second picture over there, which was an award-winning picture, I did it in black and white. So that way I have this theme that you could take this picture and almost make it like a paint-by-number picture. So I have an original. I print it I got it all digitalized, and I got this one digitalized. And you could see on this one that I took all the color out. So now we could take these pictures that are digitalized, print them any size on any medium, whether it's canvas, watercolor, or a high gloss or matte paper, any size again. And we can add images to it, like the eyes that are inside that picture there. Or on the picture over there, I put a sunset in it. But basically, it just goes to show that if you digitalize it, I can make one piece of art into many, and also I could sell somebody that picture and let them paint it whatever way they want to match their decor. It seems a lot of times these days people buy pictures not for the what's in it, but for the color that's in it, because they're trying to do color schemes. And so I think that it's important to be, diversity is important in art.
That is. That's a wonderful idea to let them choose the colors too.
Yes, it is.
No, you said something about eyes. You have more pictures with eyes in them?
Yes, I do.
Can I see those?
I'd love to show you. You know why? Because I think eyes are the gateway to your soul.
I was going to say the same thing. So.
And it seemed like in the Bible, whenever somebody wanted to know God's name, he said, I am, I am. I was wondering if maybe he said, I am. Through our eyes, our Creator sees the world that he created, or she created. But it's our eyes that show the picture. So that's the way we fill our eyes with good things to see, not the evil and the death that some people in the world, the terrorists and whatnot, are showing us. We don't need that. What we need to see is the beauty that was created. It's found everywhere. It's just like faith. If you look for it, you'll find it. I do try to do a lot with eyes. Somebody told me that that means I'm insane. But
that means you're insane?
Well, because a lot of kooky people fixate on eyes. This is one of my first stick figure eye creations, and this is at Battery Park down in New York, in Manhattan, where I was down there for September 11th. And I took that's my wife, Susie, there. And what we did was go down to the Battery Park, and that's the sphere that was between the two twin towers when it crashed. And so I brought what I call Suzette down there and dressed her up for New York. So she's all styling. So it's called Suzette Styling in Battery Park. And so now wherever I go, Suzette goes with me too.
Suzette gets around.
She sure does. I did a
there
show.
She is over at Starbucks.
That's right. And Starbucks was nice enough to show me as one of their gallery participants. And it's very difficult to get gallery space, and it's like a closed door a lot of times. But I got Suzanne in Northampton, and she's dressed in her Northampton tie-dyes, which is what they enjoy up there. And I slipped myself as a
who's
self.
Who's that man in the corner?
Oh,
that handsome man.
He looks like General Grant or General Lee from the Civil War, I think. But basically, that's me. And what I did was there was somebody's body there, and I had to take my head and put it over their body, otherwise I would have had to have signatures and releases like we had to sign this morning.
We can't track that man down.
No.
Or bother him.
Remember my deer pictures over there?
Oh no, Suzette goes to the deer.
And she has her little Sony camcorder that some people really love to shoot with.
So Suzette was in New York.
Yep.
She was at Starbucks, and now she's in Westfield.
Yeah, that's right, and she's got her favorite camis on and her little beret again. She just loves her beret. I think she's French.
Oh wow, look at this one.
That's called Bird's Eye because when I took this original picture, it was of my friend that helped me with the memorial. Mm-hmm. You'll see him later, Dave's Eye. And Dave, let me be one of these.
So that's Dave's Eye?
That's Dave's Eye. And this is Hanging Dave's Eye. Now, what happened was I turned Dave's Eye and just did a little reverse color. And it, when I did the picture, it almost looked like a tropical bird.
Wow.
With a cock's comb and with its feathers for its wings and a beak, kind of like showed up. And maybe not everybody sees that, but that's artistic for you.
Right, it's what you see.
It's what I see. So I took Dave and Dave's hanging eye, and then I also made it into like a southwestern adobe kind of picture with my I Ching thing that came out of it. And this is one of my first Adobe Photoshop layer PSDs, but that's what they call it, where you take parts of different pictures and put it together. And it's called Pi Eye because that symbol there is Pi in I Ching. And I Ching is a book that tells you how to go about your life. When you're caught in between a decision and you don't know which side of the fence you want to lean to, You roll these pennies, you ask the question, and I Ching will answer that question. And so far, it's been incredibly correct for me.
Is it always correct?
It's always correct for me. It's how I got to meet and marry my wife. I met her on school bus, and I tried to date her, and I just couldn't get her to go out with me. I didn't realize she was going through a separation, but I kept asking her out, and that determination thing that I said, now, it was destiny for me to meet her, mm-hmm. but it was determination that made it happen.
Right.
I Ching gave me the path. It said, ask her children out, and I was driving her children on school bus, and I asked her children out to the Muppet movie, and that was in 79, and they came running off the bus and said, Mom, can we go to the movies with Jerry? And she said, as long as I can go too. So we went to the movies together, held hands, mm-hmm. and as they say, the rest is history. True love spoken. I had to give up 6 girlfriends for her.
Okay. I want to know more about this later.
This is a pool table shot in my house, and we were playing late at night, and I said to my friend Kevin, who also is one of my volunteer helpers for the memorial, I said, Kevin, I got to get this shot. I got to do something different with eyes. I said, I'll make them into pool balls. He says, how are you going to do that? I said, watch.
How did you do that?
I took the shot of the pool balls, and I put it on my computer, and I took my individual eye shots, and I cut them to circles, and I made them look a little shinier using my Adobe Photoshop. And I inserted them on top of the pool balls, but I left the cue ball in the eight ball, so that way you got the sense that you're playing pool, and it's called Keep Your Eyes on the Game. And then here's a couple more beautiful eyes on their own, but then I started working with my flowers with the eyes. So,
wish I had purple eyes.
Or those green ones.
Green ones.
And this girl I met over at one of my shows in West Springfield, she had gorgeous eyes. I look for different things when I take eye pictures. I look for iris content, how it's layered, or the depth of the darkness of
how
the browns.
How close do you have to be to the eye to get that picture?
Very close, and later on I could take a picture of your eye if you like. It's not an exact science, but it's something that you just got to do a couple times and you're going to get a nice clear shot. It's macro, it's very tight. And what I look for is shape of eyes. I look for if they're wearing a lot of makeup, what they did with the makeup, because that'll show up when I do a reverse color.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking for a depth, and the most depth on eyes is usually a hazel eye because it's layered. Blue eyes usually have all the sparkle in it. Brown eyes are very deep. But hazel eyes have pilings of different colors on top of each other, almost like in a painting where you put a color and then you glaze it and put another color and glaze it. Here's another eye picture. I'm very much into astronomy. One of my goals in the future was, as I went from being an artist to a book writer into movies, I eventually wanted to be a scientist. I've been doing a lot of studying on my own via the internet, and I have my own concepts on the way the universe was built and the way everything is actually made with vortexes. And I just happened to want to do something different, and I wanted to do a solar system picture. What I was looking for was the sun with all the planets spread out. What I got on the internet was this picture by Calvin J. Hamilton, who was a great astrologer. He's into the planets. And it just shows all the different planets in the angle, which is called obliquity. And it shows how some planets, their poles are actually sideways compared to ours. Mm. And how some planets spin one way, but other planets spin the other way. And I think that's all just working in harmony in the universe to hold planets in their own specific orbits to each other. And so he was very nice when I emailed him. I didn't know what results I would get, but I know because of copyrights, you shouldn't use somebody else's pictures unless you ask them. It's the same with all artistic endeavors. Please respect other people's copyrights. I called him. He was very nice to me, and he said, yes, Jerry, use my picture. So I put the eyes. And Nancy earlier, my sister-in-law, that's her eye there. And that's my nephew's eye. And that's a good friend of mine's eye. And I don't know the rest of them because I've taken so many. But what we not only did was take the eyes in the picture and try to teach you about astrology, try to teach you about eyes, but also it has this saying that teaches you how to learn the planets. And it's called, man very early made jars serve useful, necessary purposes, which stands for Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto. So we've got like another multi kind of art thing where it's not just art, it's art and teaching. Mm. And this being a teaching center, it kind of will go with it. And then here's a couple fun ones. This is called Hypnoized. I just used a little bit of blurring, and it kind of draws you in. Mm. And this girl was an Asiatic girl, and she was working at Burger King. And after my West Springfield show that I won with that picture there, I just saw her eyes, and I said, can I take your eye pictures? And she said, sure. and that's what I did. And this is Tiger Swallow Eye. Because
whose eyes are those?
Well, these eyes are my cat, who's a tiger.
It's your cat.
And he loves chasing butterflies, so I kind of merged them together. And the tiger swallowtail is in my yard on top of one of my dianthus, which I love growing plants and flowers, and it gives me a subject matter. Mm-hmm. And people ask me, well, why did you start with photography if you're going to be an artist? I said, well, photography, first of all, is easy. You can grab a camera and you can go shoot all day long. Number two, it gives you a great portfolio that later on you could paint off them. So now you have your artwork sitting there. So you could pull the picture of a rose out or a lily or something and paint it. But what I found is that when I do my photography, maybe like many, but maybe unlike any, is that my photography turns out to almost be like a painting to begin with. Something steps into it that I'm not aware of that makes it more than just a photograph. And it's not the manipulation on the computer that does it. Maybe it's the camera itself, but somehow something magical occurs to some of my pictures. I started as an artist again, probably you might as well say with the memorial and with the deer pictures, and that was in 01. And here it is 04. So within 3 years, I've taught myself computers, Adobe Photoshop, digital camera techniques. I'm doing as much as I possibly can. I'm learning how to restore a historical building and just take every step as I can and learn as much as I can. Eventually it'll all come together and maybe I can help others learn that.
Right. Yeah. And speaking about helping out, can we see your photos of the 9/11 War Against Terrorism Memorial? You can show me the book you were talking about.
I'd love to.
Thank you.
Well, Lynn, here we are. And what I first wanted to show you was the volunteers that we were talking about up at the memorial, how Dan showed up and helped out, and how Nancy was saying that my nephews and kids all helped out and they cleaned up the memorial at the end of the job, and everybody added a little bit of help. Well, here's my friend that gave me his eye pictures. That's Dave. So that's keep your eye.
Okay. Dave's eye.
Dave's eye.
Okay.
And this is my friend Kevin, who's in nukes. He's a nuclear. He works on the nuclear plants, and he helped me, and he was playing pool with me on keep your eyes on the game.
All right.
But basically, what we have here is the very beginning of the memorial, where Larry was saying how they had to get rid of the landscaping that was there first. Mm-hmm. So that's when you drive in, you see all that stuff was cut out from there to there. So what they had was just the cobblestone to work with. So what I had them do was, let's just get this memorial going. This is what we want to do. And they went ahead and did the work for it. They took out the plants. They put the cobblestone around. We used old fireplaces for our two twin towers, which look more like gravestones here. Mm-hmm. They did the bell site. So we got everything kind of laid out with the heart. And then I brought in the tulip bulbs for the red tulips. So the next step was to take, and there's Larry right there working hard, and Pete. We were laying down all the dirt and all the tulips. And then we took the rocks, which is just white stone that Larry got donated. And we laid it down, and then we designed this way to paint the stripes and the flag on the memorial. And then
so
we took
the first incarnation of your memorial.
Yes.
And all of it is stones in the shape of a flag of a heart. And I think that's something that we could all do at home.
You could all do a simple little design like this, and if you like the design,
patriotic,
feel free to use it. We found that this design actually, after this was done, maybe everybody else kind of had the same idea because their hearts were broken and we were all patriotic. So you see the flag in a heart almost everywhere now. I have a picture somewhere that shows it in New York City when I went down there for September 11th the next year. So we got it all painted and we had to put the stars on. So I made a little, I'm a tin knocker, so I cut a little piece of tin into the shape of a star and spray painted it.
Cool.
And while we were there, they were hanging the flag, and I thought that was important because it's actually, without knowing it,
right, I see that. folded flag that became the top of your memorial.
Excellent. And we painted the green around it to try to give it the feel that it's alive. So here we go with the painting around it. I've got it all painted. And there it is, a large shot of that.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And there's the first signs of the vandalism. Mm. So they walked right through it and did a swastika, I believe, or something similar to that. And that showed us that we needed that fence.
So how upsetting was that after it happened?
It was very upsetting. Because not for the work was done, because the work at that point wasn't important at all, and it wasn't that hard.
Right.
It was just the feeling that people must have known that it was important, because it was never there before. And then just to do that, either children or somebody spiteful.
So that happens, and then there's another idea to do the memorial that we see now?
Well, this kind of, we already had the idea that we were going to do the memorial. It just gave us the idea that we better close it, and that's where the fence came in.
Okay.
So we let the flowers bloom. But just before they bloomed, we started working on the fence, and that was in, I believe, early March. We had a very easy winter that year, so we jumped right into it. We started setting the posts with the help of the state workers. We laid the fence out and cut it to the length. We had to make 9-foot fence into 12-foot long. They delivered the fence with the trucks and the tractors. Like they said, they had everything going. And you could see how we surrounded as much as we could go. We surrounded the memorial, the existing memorial. And the tulips bloomed. And to me, that was a solace in itself, because, you know, that was for all the people that actually died. And I kept the tulip bulbs, and I left them outside, and squirrels ate them. Sad but true. So there it is with it blooming, and with some close-ups of it. And then from there, I did my scale model and tried to design it with the original heart. And then that changed as we started laying it out. So it was free-flowing. It wasn't like I could just step up to the bat.
So it evolved.
Evolved, exactly. Excellent word. And you could show how everybody stepped in. We had, I did the site work and then laid it out with a...
You were pouring concrete.
Very quickly. And it was nice because when the concrete truck came up, they had just put flags on their trucks.
Huh?
To like, for being patriotic, you saw flags everywhere. You still do, which is very nice.
Very nice.
And we started doing the concrete, and Larry was there
again. Larry
again. Larry's working hard.
Larry's busy.
He says, help. Comes in the nick of time. Say hi to Larry, a very hard-working man. He should be considering he's in charge of the state park here at Hannon Ponds. Larry's the one that invited me to design the September 11th War Against Terrorism Memorial. Thanks, Larry. Then it says, the early rule of don't break the broke bank applies to the state park system. Virtually all the materials used or donated are now out of pocket. My pocket. But we don't care about that.
Your pocket for the memorial and also for your artwork, too?
Absolutely. Everything I do is as I can afford it. I'm not a rich man. I guess if I put my that energy that we talk about of the memorial and of what I'm doing here, if I put that to being rich, I probably would be rich. But riches aren't important. It's doing the right thing and doing it for people.
Right, because that pays you in the end more than any kind of money would.
Absolutely. You get it paid in multitudes back.
Mm-hmm.
So the more you can do for others, the more you'll find that it comes back to you. And it is very true. I had help with the fence, and they showed me how to grind and not cut my fingers off and to weld. And so to bring it back over to here. And we started the sandblasting, and even though Joe doesn't really like war, like most people, he did enjoy helping me, and he treated me very well, didn't charge me a lot for the work he did. And then we went into painting, and you can see my old van, that's the one I took the picture from up on top of the ladder on it, and Larry's who? Larry again. Larry was very...
Larry's in the cage.
Always working in the cage there. So we got the painting going on, and then the tiles were given to me and delivered. And we started working on the tiles and laying them out, trying to get an idea of what we needed, how many more I had to buy compared to what was given to us. And it says right here, it's tile time. Have you tiled before? Me neither. Thanks, Jim, for getting me started.
Can you do my kitchen next?
So here we are, and by that, this time it's June, and I've worked the whole month of June every day.
And you're racing the deadline too, right?
The deadline was coming up fast, and the heat was getting hotter and hotter. As you can see, I was getting very sunburned. But like I said, the thunderstorms never came over me, and we just kept working. We're good friends helping out. It got done in time. And here's a time lapse of the tiles getting done. Lay them out, do your border, start doing the fill, 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 get the heart, got it done. And then my wife and my grandson and my great nephew and my sister-in-law Nancy all came over, and we all had buckets of water and sponges, and we were cleaning till 9:30 on July the 3rd, 2002, and it opened up at 9 in the morning.
Wow. This is what you hand out, right?
This is the little picture that I took from on top of my van that you saw. And that's the one I hand out. This is the same picture that I went down to NYC to Manhattan and handed out at the Twin Tower site. This is the picture that Bob from Imagine That Video got, and that's how he knew about it. And this is how I'm trying to promote it. And these are always free of charge. You know, I don't know what they cost me a piece, but that's not important. Right. It's another out-of-pocket. Try to get this thing known. Because it seemed like I didn't only just build a memorial, I became its keeper.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I have no problem coming back and doing repairs. I have no problems going out and being the spokesperson for it. And I have absolutely no problem of handing out pictures and being here on film to show you what I try to do for everybody.
If anybody would like a copy of this that's watching, they can just contact you at the website.
Just contact me on the website. That's the Twin Towers where I told you that it was illuminated. And see how it spills across the tiles. And I had somebody, and I don't know, they just said...
What time of day was that taken at?
That was at dusk. And the person said, is that the Twin Towers? I said, no, that's the Twin Towers at the memorial.
It does look like the actual...
Yeah, just like the actual, because they don't see the fencing. They just see the illumination. So I accomplished what I was trying to do. Here's some close-up shots of the bell and the memorial from way up high.
How high is that? And can you see this from an airplane or a helicopter?
I would say you'd be able to see it from a couple thousand feet up. I think it would be large enough. And I was up about 15, 20 feet when I took that picture.
Okay.
It's quite a view. And it's interesting because this picture, too, I was back farther and up at the same height. But the perspective of the shot, I was told, was excellent. But what happens is that it gets diminutive.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know how large a person is in there. I have to tell people that these towers are almost 6 feet tall. Mm-hmm. For you to realize that the fence is almost 7 feet tall.
Mm-hmm.
And that the whole memorial is much larger than it looks in this picture. And then, just to try to get a feel... As the memorial was progressing, I had these at the gate of the state park, and somebody could get a free picture if they filled one of these out.
Mm-hmm.
So we had them just answer a few questions. Were you directly affected by the 9/11 tragedy? Comments on the memorial? Comments to the president? And how would you unite the world in peace?
So you got quite a few responses, huh?
I have at least,
it gives you an idea of the type of people that visit the memorial, too, or what people are thinking.
Exactly, Lynn. This is another thing where my destiny's taken me, and I wouldn't have got these shots, which are an incredible, I think, one-of-a-kind shot, where I captured the Statue of Liberty through a sign that's on the water. The Statue of Liberty's 3.5 miles away, and I had to position myself.
So this sign was already there?
Yes.
Okay.
That's one of the ferry signs. And remember the ferry that crashed last September in Manhattan? Well, I took these pictures 2 weeks prior to that on September 11th, and I believe the ferry crashed on the 23rd through the 27th. And it was right where I took this picture, within one or two signs down. The signs go from one to, I believe, six. And I just happened to be there for September 11th, handing out my pictures again like I do, and seeing how year two had gone through. And I knew that the sign was there, and I just brought a ladder with me this time, and I got up high enough to get the base of the statue into the number one. And now that they're opening up the statue to the public again since 9/11, I'm going to try to get this down to Mayor Bloomberg, and and see if he'll dedicate this not only to the Statue of Liberty reopening, but to all the people that lost somebody on that ferry, because people died there too. And it's not a matter of how you die, it's your quality of life. Mm-hmm. We're not here for very long, and you can die as an individual or as a group. And it doesn't hurt you when you die, it just hurts everybody else that loved you when you're gone. Mm-hmm. And so I want to make sure that if there's something I could do for those people as well as for the people of 9/11 that I'm there for, because that's why I probably saw this picture. It wasn't for my own enjoyment. And so what I did was make a series of postcards that I'm sending down to the mayor and also to the President of the United States that just shows how this goes to this, goes to that. And so I got this one already made out to Mayor Bloomberg. It's supposed to go in the mail today. There's my patriotic stamp on it.
Right.
And so it is a very nice picture, and I hopefully it will be recognized for what it is, which is a very unique perspective on the statue, that liberty in our lives is a number one focus.
And that I think you've shown that to us today through everything that you've shown us.
Well, I appreciate that. And it's something that I didn't really have before 9/11. Mm-hmm. It's something that has grown inside me. It's like a destiny calling.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel very strongly about it, and I feel very secure knowing that I know who I am and that I could give this of myself without ever affecting who I am, but by growing better every day as a person,
mm-hmm.
sacrificing. It's the least I can do, like I said. It's for everybody.
Is this the picture that you're going to give to the president?
Yes, and I was going to send it to him at first, and here it has already made it out to him, dedicated to the Commander-in-Chief and President of the United States of America, George Walker Bush. Best wishes, Gerald Eugene Tracy. I had it made out 12/14/03 of last year, but then I thought to myself, let's make this a community event. Maybe I can get him to come to Westfield. We have the 104th Fighter Wing. We have the 104th Infantry. We have Chickabee, the Air Force Base over Westover. Maybe we can get him here to pick this picture up. So that's why those postcards are going to be important. When I send him a postcard, he'll get an idea of it. I'll send him a 1,000 pictures of the memorial with the writing on the back and tell him if he knows anybody that's been hurt, because he could find these names out easier than me. Then maybe we can get his attention. And seeing as how he's running against a Democrat from Massachusetts and John Kerry, that maybe he'll come down and use it as a little bit of a publicity for himself,
right,
and come and pick this beautiful picture up.
Can't have it unless he comes and gets it.
That's what I'm imagining, and this just goes to show that at least somebody in our political offices
appreciates the work that you've done.
Okay. Yes, here you go. And so that was made out by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and our own local representative, Don Humerson.
It's in recognition of your many artistic and cultural contributions to Hampton Ponds and the greater Westfield community.
Means as much as anything to me. Not something I expected, but something that was given to me. And it was given to me at Ann Wilmot's, who you don't know about her, but she's the oldest living resident of the United States, I believe at 105, and she rows her boat across that pond that we're up at.
Okay.
Every day when it's nice out. And she rowed the mayor across. So if the president comes down, she may row the president across, and I'm trying to get Mayor Bloomberg to come too. And if we can have both of them come down here.
So we're going to sing, I'm a little teapot here, and row your boat down
the pond. If we could get Bloomberg and the president here in Westville at the same time, that would be an incredible feat. Somebody says, oh, you can't do that. But like I always tell everybody.
Well, they probably told you couldn't do all this.
Well, that's true, too.
Okay.
I believe you have a mouth to ask, and somebody else has a mouth to say yes or no. So never be afraid to ask a question. Questions are what it takes to get answers.
Mm-hmm. So here we are outside Jerry's building. What can you tell me about what you're going to do to the outside over here in the front?
Well, I'm going to do a couple different things. What I'm going to do is take those windows that you see with the tape, and that'll kind of be where our signs are. And that's very old glass. It was broken, so I had to replace it anyways. So it'll be a little teapots in the ones that have the tape.
Okay.
Now, what I'm going to do is take the whole front right off, and I'm going to put a full set of sliders in the middle and a handicap door on the left with a handicap ramp.
Uh-huh.
So it's important to let everybody be able to get and see the artwork and enjoy the facilities. So we're going to have a handicap accessible with a handicap bathroom. On the right will be a little serving window where you see that pole and the people walking by.
Uh-huh.
That'll be a little serving window. Maybe we could serve soft serve with my wife loves so much.
Okay.
And Italian ices and our teas out the window and maybe coffees. And then above that, we're going to redo that awning, which I have an awning guy coming to look.
Okay.
And then above that, you can see the upstairs, the teaching and learning center. That's all going to be copper. I'm going to take those tin ceiling copper panels and put them on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll make it really shiny and it'll stand out.
Definitely.
And as they age, they'll get to that nice green color that you see on the top and bottom.
Yep.
So what we'll have is nice green doors that open right up to the street, and the brick will look like it goes right into the building at street level.
Hmm.
We'll have the awning. The awning comes out. We'll have a couple little tables out there, so at nighttime, you could sit around summer and just relax.
Have some ice cream.
Yes.
Something to drink.
Something to drink.
See some artwork.
See some artwork and watch
everybody. Do a little dance.
And just enjoy the night away.
Jerry, there's a lot of open area right here. What are you going to do to this?
Well, Lynn, what I was looking at doing was, because Westfield is such a historical city,
mm-hmm.
and had such a beauty to it and has been changing throughout the centuries, is that I'm going to take the views from old picture cards and postcards, like the ones I make it for the president and for the mayor, and take these old pictures of Westfield downtown area that you can see and show it from one decade to another and have pictures of old Westfield down the side of the building. And so that way you could come down the street and say, that's what Westfield looked like in 1790 or 1840 or the turn of the century in the 1900s or before they put the front of the building on in 1950.
Mm.
And you could get a feel for what Westfield was like back then. And what I'm going to try to do is do the same thing for this building over here and see if they'll cooperate with that theme, because they have another nice long wall.
Right.
And instead of just seeing brick, let's show them some art, and let's show them some culture and some heritage and some history at the same time. And when people come into town from far away or haven't been here in 20, 30 years, they'll come in and they'll say, I've never seen that before. That's what this place used to look like? Well, yes, that's when it had carriages, and that's when it had people walking, and the streets were always filled with people, and that's what we want to do again.
Yep.
Fill the streets with people. So I think it'll be a nice touch. We'll make the pictures so that they're waterproof and that they're permanent and nobody can take them. What we won't do is paint them on, because paint seems to peel like the paint on the side of my building.
Right.
But I think it'll be a nice touch, and it'll be a little bit of a gift to Westfield, because it'll show their history where people can actually see it.
Mm.
And Westfield's a popular town. I was just here the other day working on my building when I saw a photo shoot going on with young kids. So I stopped them, took my camera out, and asked them, what are you guys doing? Well, we just started a new teen magazine, the guy said. I said, really? I said, well, why are you in Westfield? Are you a Westfield magazine? He says, no, we're from Flint, Michigan. I said, why'd you pick Westfield? He said, Westfield has these beautiful old buildings. It's very quaint, very safe, peaceful, has these nice nook and crannies. We really love Westfield. When I was telling you about the deer picture in the magazine, I talked to John Nunn, who's the publisher of National Wildlife.
Right.
And he said, I drove to Westfield one town. I love the city. So I just want people to be able to see that it is a place that you can fall in love with.
And they can come downtown and enjoy themselves and enjoy the art, and then walk down the street and not even have to go in to see what you've done.
Exactly. And the reason I picked Westfield was because Westfield's at the start of a birth, it's a renaissance. Mm-hmm. I could see it, I could feel it, I could sense it. When I talk about it, people feel that energy and they sense it.
Mm-hmm.
And just like talking about that magazine doing that shooting, it's starting to happen. There's a lot of places here for rent that I'm trying to bring artists into. There's a lot of places for sale that I'd love to bring artists into. Once we have the school going, the Center for the Arts, with the help of the city working with me and working with the other groups, then, like I said, maybe we can make this truly a special place, an art place for everybody, a cultural center, a place where you could come and learn karate and teach it to somebody,
mm-hmm.
and that somebody may teach you watercolor painting or maybe how to crochet. So we can all be culturally refined and as diverse as possible.
We couldn't ask for a better man to do this project.
Well, thank you very
for,
much.
And for a better citizen of Westfield.
Well, I work hard at what I'm doing, and I have my back into it. I'd like to do all these things for everybody. If I fall short on some things, I'm sure there won't be any finger pointing. I'm just going to do what I can. I'm only human, but like I said before, there's an I in you in community. So if you step up to the plate, and it's the same plate I'm stepping up to, we can work together as a team, and we can get things done.
Definitely. I want to thank you, Jerry, for taking the time to show us around today, the 9/11 War Against Terrorism Memorial and your gallery. Such beautiful artwork.
Well, thank you very much. My artwork comes from my heart and goes out to the people. I hope they enjoy it as much as I enjoy it. That's what art's all about. And again, thank you again for coming up about the memorial, because it's important to get the message out that this memorial's here for everybody. And it's not just something about me. It's something about them.
Now, we want to come back when the gallery's open, maybe for the grand opening?
You're going to have a very nice invitation in the mail for the grand opening. I don't think I could have a grand opening without you people. You're that special.
We're special.
Yes, you are. And you're becoming more special.
Thank you.
And maybe we can come up here because the memorial will be all finished at the same time. And you can see
what
we've done.
And then we can show everybody the finished product.
Yes, and maybe we can have some improvements. Maybe we'll have a sign by that time.
And possibly, even though maybe not soon, we could have it enclosed with glass and a roof.
I sure wish that...
That's your long-term goal?
Long-term goal. If we can get the volunteers and the money to put together, then if we can close it in, I think it'd be the right thing
right.
to do.
Sounds like a good idea. Thanks for joining us.
You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you.
To learn more about Gerald Eugene Tracy, his artwork, the 9/11 War Against Terrorism Memorial, or to volunteer, please visit his website. Let us know what you think about any of our episodes. Call us at 204-6714 with your ideas, suggestions, complaints, or comments. On the Scene and Imagine That Productions is always looking for a new crew, volunteer crew, and hosts. If you're interested in a career in broadcasting, please let us know. Besides being fun, it's also a great way to learn a little bit more about this place that we call home. Make it a point to visit the 9/11 War Against Terrorism Memorial here at Hampden Pond State Park in Westfield, Massachusetts. Come and show your support for the families and victims of 9/11, as well as all of our troops who have served or are still serving over in Iraq. I'm Lynn Clark. Thank you for joining us for this episode of On the Scene. And good night.
Well, if you ask me where I come from, here's what I tell everyone. I was born by God's dear grace in an extraordinary place, where the stars and stripes and the eagle fly. It's a big old land with countless dreams, and happiness ain't out of reach. Hard work pays off the way it should. Yeah, I've seen enough to know that we've got it good, where the stars and the stripes and the eagle fly. Stands in a harbor for what we believe. And there's a bell that still echoes the price that it costs to be free. I pledge allegiance to this flag, and if that bothers you, well, that's too bad. But if you got pride and you're proud, you do. We could use some more like me and you, where the stars and stripes and the eagle fly. Yeah, really believe. And there's a bell that still echoes, the price that it costs to be free. No, it ain't the only place on earth, but it's the only place that I prefer to love my wife and raise my kids. Hey, the same way that my daddy did. With the stars and stripes and the eagle flies. Where the stars and stripes and the eagle flies. Looking at the promise of the promised land.